And welcome back. Being pregnant in this time can be extremely challenging. According to the CDC, African American, Indian, and Native American women are 2 to 3 times more likely to die from pregnancy-related causes than white women, and the disparity increases with age. Research has demonstrated such disparities like the egregious race-based difference in maternal mortality and the increased rates preterm birth reflect differences of quality of care, as well as decreased access to care, discriminatory treatment, and also other social determinants of health. Doulas are actually one way that they can help solve the social justice issue. Here now to provide more is the founder and lead advocate at the Federation of International Gender and Human Rights, Dr. Ameena Ali. And we thank you, Dr. Ali, for joining us again.
Hello. Thank you so much for having me once again. I always enjoy coming on. Thank you.
No, great to have you. It is certainly a conversation that needs to be had. I think when we talk about a lot of the healthcare disparities that go on, particularly that affect the African-American community, we can talk about diabetes, you can talk about HIV and AIDS, we can talk about cancer. But sometimes when it comes to maternal health, that doesn't always rise to the top, even though those numbers are extremely high.
It is. The unfortunate piece in that is that there isn't a continuity of care. So what I mean by that is there is a complement to care, which means that there is accessibility if you're in an urban area or if you're in an area that has resources that are available, you know, free clinics, clinics that are well maintained for women and maternal care. But for those that are language barred or disability barred, or those that just don't know that those programs exist, it could be sitting right next door to you and it not be accessed. And this is where we're trying to tie that gap. We're trying to make it a household name. And as we say, we're normalizing maternal health care in urban households.
Yeah. How would you define maternal health care as far as being a social justice issue? Obviously, we're on the social justice forums, but for somebody who asked the question about maternal health care, social justice, how do the two go together? How do you answer that?
Well, basically, if you are pregnant in the United States, we shouldn't even be having this conversation. This is a huge, huge thing that we sit back and scratch our heads. Social justice just means just that. It is justice for us in the parameters of where we are economically, where we are geographically, and where we are demographically. And there is a big disparity between the three. The fact that we're here in the United States and we have to talk about this issue means that there is an intentional non-implication of these services. So that means they intended not even to offer these. So whatever it is that we have to provide it for ourselves. Well, 9 times out of 10, we as people of color especially, we tend to do things the way it is comfortable for us and as things are necessary. So necessity is the mother of invention. Mm-hmm. However, we have to make sure that we are up to par with that when we deal with maternal health care. We can't be dealing with 60s mindsets and we're talking about going into the new, you know, 21st century. So I think that what we're doing now is we're becoming more aware that there is a disparity, and now this is where the advent of help comes.
Yeah, and we talk about healthcare, obviously a major component in making sure that maternal healthcare is going in favor of those who receive services. Talk to us about what you see, what you like, and what you don't like.
What I see is there's a big gap, and I'm praying that it will be closed at least a little bit before I close my eyes. What I like is that we're having these conversations. You know, the fact that you have me on here speaking about it in different parameters, leveling up on what it is that's being offered, and then allowing the women to know that it is here in the Bronx, which is the least accessed in the care as well as the programs. So the fact that the Bronx is getting it and getting it firsthand allows us to know that it's going to be divvied out in other communities. Now, what I don't like, oh my goodness, we could be here all day and I know we only have a few minutes. So what I can say is that if I can get more people to get on board to become a doula, just to become a doula, that would set the record in how many people have access to the care. If you do it in Washington Heights, someone does it in Inwood, someone else does it in East Harlem, someone else does it in, I don't know, Brooklyn. You will have more people addressed to those issues and more people speaking about it. So this is what I don't like. The numbers of becoming a doula are going down because they don't see the money in it. And it's not. There isn't any money in being a doula. It is all of the outcome, not the income. So it is about what it is that we're giving. So it has to be passionate people that want to do the work. So what we need to do is develop a different way to bring that passion home. And I think that's where we're doing with the COVID and post-COVID resources that we're aligning.
Dr. Ali, sometimes, you know, we throw around the word doula and we assume that everybody knows exactly what a doula is. So for somebody who really doesn't know what a doula is, the work that goes into being a doula, would you please explain?
A doula is to a patient as the nurse is to the hospitalized person. So a midwife would be the doctor, the doula would be the nurse. So as it pertains to maternal care, those that come into your service, you're pregnant or your wife is pregnant, you would automatically call a midwife who would bring a doula, just like a doctor would bring a nurse. And most midwives worth their salt will not practice without one. This is saying that midwives, you know, they don't come into the birth space by themselves empty-handed. They come with the visuals, they come with the tools, and they also come with the education, which is what the doula brings. The doula is the day-to-day, the midwife is on the event. So that means when it's labor, when it's time to birth, when she is in active labor, that's when the midwife steps in. Everything else is normally the doula. And she brings the education, the passion, the knowledge, the information. She brings the calmness and she brings the know-how to get her safely to that point of birthing babies. So this is where we need more doulas, and we definitely need the advent of more doulas with different languages. Yeah. So, you know, it is definitely necessary, especially in the Bronx.
So when we talk a little bit about the work of doulas, obviously a lot of work goes into helping that mother get across the finish line. And with COVID-19, childbirth doesn't stop. One thing that doesn't stop during COVID-19 is childbirth. Talk to us about how COVID-19 has actually impacted in the work that you're doing now, particularly post-COVID. Well, we're not even post-COVID, but, you know.
Well, COVID, you know what I mean. COVID itself brought along a lot of challenges. Oh, my goodness. The fact that the increase in home births went up 110%. 110% historic highs. We haven't even seen this in any other categories in Katrina or any other catastrophe. Home births have gone up. Why? Because women don't want to go into a hospital where there's people with possible COVID to their left and to their right. So they're wanting to birth at home. So of course, midwives that were retired, we had to come out of retirement and we had to utilize our skills to be able to get mommies into a healthy environment so that she could birth her babies. We had mommies that may have not been well, maybe had diabetes or hypertension. We had to get her medication so that she could transition into a home birth. And then there are women that were going into a hospital and for the first time ever, they said, you know what? That may not be the best environment for my baby. So now we had to educate and then get her ready for this home birth in like 2 or 3 months. So it was an odd job, but it was something doable because it was necessary. And we were scoped with it. So I really must commend all the midwives that stepped up, all the doulas that took their place, and all of the birth workers that really set a monumental high to get these women ready for home birthing and then birth them successfully. So that's the bigger piece. Yeah. As far as after COVID, we have a couple of collaborations that we're doing with the city of New York. Now, a lot of it is still a little fresh. So there's a little pushback because they don't know what to expect of it. They don't want to deal too much in health because they always want to feel like the CDC and the WHO is like God himself. But we have to deal with this because we don't have any other officials that are doing this. We don't have any other people that are showing this. So what we're doing is a three-part. We have accessibility, visibility, and accountability. Accessibility is establishing resilient, responsive, and inclusive healthcare systems that are accessible to all, irrespective of the socioeconomic or legal status. The health condition should not matter if she had pre-existing health disparities or if there's genetic or hereditary dispositions. Such systems should prioritize an essential health package based on the primary care principle. So that means it's personalized care. So instead of taking it from the institution of insurance, we're bringing it back into the hands of the women, allowing the women to make the choices and allowing the insurance to value their choices in their direction. The visibility is to have great advents to those that are reasonable accommodations. For example, we're doing primary health care, allowing them to have full spectrum care in a safe, qualified area. So that means safe as in the way the mother sees it, not the way science or maybe the hospital is wanting to present it. Because as we saw with COVID, it wasn't very safe.
Right.
And then we want to utilize the community. So if we have midwives that are in the community, they'll do a lot of their education, maybe some of their prenatal where they feel safe and they don't have to have that advent of the bacterium and the biological hazards of COVID in the hospital. And then we're dealing with well-trained, well-paid, cultural, language, and gender-sensitive health workers. This is huge. So many people have to just get what they get when they go to the hospital and they're not given that choice. So when we're dealing with these new policies, we're bringing this home into the private sector and we're allowing them to have the reliability of what they know to be true and right and bring it back home to them. And then the accountability is to know this is community-wide. So we're allowing them to be stakeholders and shareholders in their care and not just rely on what the doctor says or what the nurse says or even what the midwife says, because it is their care. So we're bringing it back home to them.
And when you talk about bringing care back home to them and then playing an active part in this, the accountability factor, I want you to just take a little bit more time and talk about that, because that accountability factor on their part is also huge.
It is. It is. We're dealing with vulnerable populations, first of all, in particular, fragile settings in maternal care, because you can't get much more fragile than maternal care. But in this, we're including disease prevention, immunization services, health promotions, and public health services. This means that each of them are going to take a part. So for example, let's say you have a son that is in Inwood, and you and your wife, let's say, had a child, and this child is getting ready to go into public health. That child is going to be educated in public health wherever, and then brought back to Inwood. So we're going to make that son now a part of the stakeholder shareholder form. So you being a native of Inwood, you being the person that is susceptible to staying there because that's where you're from, you are now going to now train your children to bring those same services back home. They're not going to go out and go to Tribeca and, you know, do the very plastic things. We're going to bring them back to their own neighborhoods and train them in their neighborhoods to serve those that they grew up with or those that they have been advantageous with to reconcile care with. So if you know that there is an oncology in, let's say, Washington Heights, your son is going to be trained in oncology and come back and service oncology in Washington Heights. So this is where we're going to make the accessibility more of an accountability. If you're going to live here, you're going to serve here. And this is to include maternal care and the women that are part of the maternal care system.
I want to talk a little bit more about the civil and social unrest that we're seeing here in our society too, and how that's impacted the work that you're doing, how it's also impacted, you know, how it's also impacted mothers. A lot of stress. And sometimes when you think about what's going on, we can tell people our blood pressure is going up, anxiety is going up. Talk about the impact that, you know, all of this has actually had that you found, particularly with mothers.
Yeah. I've had one mother say that she really wanted to leave New York. And her reason was, she said, I'm raising a Black man in New York. She said, that's the most dangerous area in the world. I said, well, you know, more of the people that are being killed recently are down south. So if where are you going to go? So she said, well, I'll go into Canada. I said, well, those are the ones that are not reported. Don't think that it's not happening. So the stress level is really becoming a big thing where women are saying they're going to distance themselves from communities and countries. A couple of women are saying now they're going to be expats going back to the continent of Africa where they don't have to worry about that. Yeah, but they have civil unrest there too. You look at Nigeria, right. Look at Cameroon. Right. You know, there is civil unrest wherever you go, and it's because of unjust governments. So why don't you stay and bloom when you're planted? Instead of leaving the area, I always recommend train a child up in the way in which it needs to go. So if there's a civil unrest for Black men, then who would be better able to stop the civil unrest than Black men? So make sure that you are in a tolerant area that allows men to be empowered, that allows the decisions to be made in their lives to be done by them, and then allow their environment to be safe. Stop tolerating injustices that are normalized, like the no snitching rule, or, you know, you don't tell what's happening in the community, or mind your business and you don't get involved in it. No, get involved. get involved and stay involved and allow the men to have that voice to say, man, you're not going to touch this woman this way, or you're not going to handle this way, and allow the men to step up and do. I grew up with that. We call them basement parties. You know, I grew up with men taking advantage of the fact that you're just not going to put your hands on a woman in my presence. You're not going to do that. And we lost that. And what's unfortunate about that is we've lost the power in our own communities. Thus, that allows other people to come into our communities and take the power from us even more. So I'm telling the women to arm themselves with knowledge, information, and the power they already have. There's more of us than there are of them. So remind their children that the more they are empowered together, the stronger our community can only be. So this is where I'm going with it. And every time I have a boy baby, I actually announce it. Here's another warrior being born. So it's an incredible passion and energy that's going out there. And I'm just glad to be a part of it.
Yeah, well, talk to me as we are getting ready to get into 2021. It's hard to believe we're already in November.
Already.
Saying, my God, 2021 is right around the corner, but it is. Your plans for 2021 and the work that's going on.
Well, we are empowering ones that are indigenous of this land and indigenous of the African continent. And what we're doing in twofold, we are getting those that are being culturally trained here and to go back to Africa. And then those that are here, they're gonna go to Africa and then come back with the culture. So what we're doing is, it's almost like a hosting or a shared environment. And we're utilizing college and high school students. So we're doing a hosting program. And that is where you have women going over there teaching about the birth involvement. And then we're having women coming from Africa to teach what's happening in Africa. And we're seeing that we're alike. 90% of the women that talk about what happened in Kenya and Rwanda and even Togo. We had a young lady from Togo speak about how she birthed into Togo. And we're looking at her like that happened in Maimonides a couple of weeks ago. Like we're looking at her with no real reason to understand that there was any difference in the birthing aspect. And that's this is an industrialized country, so we say, and that's a non-industrialized country. So why is there such a disparity? Why is there such a thing that we're seeing in 2020 that looks so relevant to their 2020, and we're in two totally different lands? So we're making the advantageous act of going there and learning, and then having them come and learn from us so that the medical professionals can now see and then give solution. So that's our 2021. I'm gonna be in West Africa with ECOWAS, and we're gonna be in Ghana, Nigeria, Gambia, Guinea, and Mali. Mm-hmm. So this is where we're gonna take our US trek into the West African countries. And then we're gonna have some from the East, South, and Central Africa coming here to the United States. So that's my 2021. And anything else is just probably gonna be more education and more influence on getting us past this COVID thing.
Yeah. Well, before we go, please give our viewers an opportunity to find out how exactly can they get in touch with you and the work that you're doing.
Sure. My website is really easy. It's FIGHR. It's like fight without the T. It's FIGHR.org. And that's the website that will have all of the programs that we have, all that we do, all the areas we're in, and especially ways that you can get involved. My email address is FIGHRINFO@gmail.com. So that's FIGHRINFO@gmail.com. And a number is 347-770-5121. That's a direct connection that also does voicemail and text. That's 347-770-5121.
Dr. Ameena Ali, our guest, thank you so much for coming and sharing with us. Great conversation, very much enlightened. And keep up the great work.
Thank you. Thank you. I'll see you again. Bye-bye.
All righty. Well, we'll have more show. We want you to stay with us. We're taking a quick break. We'll be right back right after this.